Okay, bismillah. So we'll continue, inshallah ta'ala, that we said that the one who's holding the horn is As-Sur, that is angel Israfil. And our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he spoke about his position right now. He mentioned his position vividly, salatullahi wa salam alayhi. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was describing his position, qala, the angel Israfil, the angel didn't mention him by name, قال صاحب إن صاحب الصور قد صاحب القرن التقم القرن, that he already is holding to that horn, he's holding that horn, and his eyes are fixed at the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is looking, so he already has the horn on his mouth, and his eyes are directed to the horn, to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again in a manner that suits His Majesty over there. He is now waiting for the command to be given to him to blow. What does that exactly mean to us? It means it could be in any moment. Could be in any moment. So, the angel is there, and he's not even blinking. He doesn't even dare to blink. Why? Out of fear that he might be given the command instantly, right away. And the Prophet ﷺ describing his eyes, they're like kawkab in durri, which means like these brilliant stars, which means, you know, when sometimes when you keep your eyes open, and your eye starts getting somehow, you know, some moisture in it, just to kind of to moisturize the eye, and then before it starts drying out, you start feeling it like it's shining, like glowing eventually. So this is to that extent, he's just kind of like waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting for the command to be given to him. And what we learn from this hadith is that this blast or this blow could be in any moment, could happen in any second. And again, because we're dealing with an angel, definitely that sur or that horn is going to be, you know, big enough, strong enough for an angel to deal with it. Again, how does it look like in details? Allahu Ta'ala. But this is how much we know from the sunnah of the Prophet salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. Now, how many times will that angel will blow into that trumpet or that horn? Two times. What we know, there's going to be two times. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says again in Surah Az-Zumar, وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَصَائِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. And the horn will be blown, and whoever is in the heavens and whoever is on the earth will fall dead except whom Allah wills. So that was the first one. And then it will be blown again. ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى. That's one more time. And at once they will be standing looking on. So they basically will be resurrected. They will stand on, looking, waiting for the command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to head further, of course, towards what we call it, Al-Hashr. So two times. And how is it going to look like? Is it going to be, are there going to be any other signs for them that it's going to happen? The answer is no. No more signs after the last signs of the Day of Judgment. So those who will be witnessing this sight or this event already got all the signs from before. So there are no more signs coming for them. When it happens, it's going to happen extremely, extremely suddenly. Even the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he described how people completely are heedless, they have absolutely have no clue what was going on around them in their lives. They're just like we mentioned the first hadith earlier, that those two shepherds, they're taking their animals to Medina to sell them. Like there's nothing happening around, just moving on with their lives. The Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that to show how people completely heedless about what's going on that day, that the day as-sa'ah, it will be established when the two people in the marketplace will spread the thawb, which means they spread the garment between themselves. They bargain over buying it and selling it, and they would not be able to sell it. They won't be able to fold it back even. So when the blast takes place, when the horn's been blown into it, that's it. Their life is going to come to an end. They will drop. They will not be able to fold it, not be able actually to take it away. And the Prophet ﷺ also mentioned that a person will be carrying the milk he just got from the she-camel. Someone just milked his camel and is carrying the camel to go and feed off of it or give to the family. And this person will hear the blast, he will drop dead, which means fall dead, before even tasting that milk. There's no risk for them, no provision for them to taste that milk. The Prophet ﷺ also mentioned, and the Day of Judgment and the hour will be established while the person is busy fixing his water basin, which is basically like does kind of preparing his farm or preparing his barn for his camels and for his animals. Like again, There is nothing happening around them. And he will fix it. He will have it ready, perhaps filled with water. And he is happy at his achievement. Before he brings his camels, he will die. Why? Because the day of judgment will be established before even using it. And the Prophet ﷺ said that the person will be eating, which means they finished their food, they cooked their food, prepared their food, and now he's holding the food in his hand, and he's raising it to his mouth, and he will drop dead before even tasting, before even being able to taste that food. This is how sudden that hour will be established, which means people will be completely heedless of the surrounding, and all the signs that they got from before, they're just going to pass that stage right now and moving on in life like nothing is going to happen or nothing is happening around them. What will happen when the horn is blown into it? What exactly will be happening here? You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the events in many, many surahs in the Quran. Some of them short surahs that vividly describe the events of the Day of Judgment are Surah Al-Takwir, Surah Al-Infitar, Surah Al-Inshiqaq. These three surahs are actually in the 30th juz of the Quran, the last juz of the Quran. And there are other surahs as well describing it. I'm going to share with you, inshallah ta'ala, some of these ayat. Okay, I guess this one is not allowing us to get in there. It's not giving the option. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm going to just basically, we had actually a translation up for you, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Takwir, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ انْكَدَرَتْ. So speaking about the events that will unfold and the sight that you will see. What are the sights? Can you guys remember with me? What are the main events Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describing in these ayat? About, first of all, about what? Ash-shams. What's going to happen to Ash-shams, to the sun? Will fall, will collapse. What else going to happen? Where the nujumu and kadarat, talking about the stars. What's going to happen to the stars? So it's falling and collapsing as well. What else? Tell me about other events of the Day of Judgment that Allah has mentioned that's going to happen. The mountain, Jibal Suyirat. What's the meaning of Jibal Suyirat? Like these mountains that you see them fixed, they're going to become so light, like traveling, like flying in the air. And Allah described these Jibal in another ayah, another surah, a short surah in the Quran says what? Jibal Kal'ihn Al-Manfush, which means they're going to look like what? Like cotton. Another ayah, Allah described them as being what? Dust, completely. So everything's going to start, you know, crumbling and falling and collapsing. How about the sea? What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about the sea? إِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ. Sujirat, how could the water, you know, become, sujirat means becomes fire. How could the water becomes fire, jama'ah? Isn't that completely the opposite? Because what we know about water, what does it do to the fire? Extinguishes fire, right? But now Allah is saying that even the sea, even the oceans will turn into fire, which means what? The volcanoes from underneath, the lava starts coming out from underneath, that even the ocean and the water start boiling. We start boiling completely. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also spoke about إِذَا السَّمَاءُ انْفَطَرَتْ وَإِذَا الْكَوَاكِبُ انْتَشَرَتْ, which means now the planets start now kind of losing of course their order and their orbits, and they start crashing into each other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرْ, that the sun and the moon will crash into each other. Of course, the size is not important right now, but they're going to crash into each other. So Allah Azza wa Jal is mentioning lots of events. So as you can see, the when you try to visualize the event, it's going to be extremely, extremely chaotic. Extremely, extremely chaotic. The order of this universe, as we see today, will come to collapse. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the Quran, He praises Himself by keeping order in this universe, right? وَكُلُّهُمْ فِي فَلَكٍ يَسْبَحُونَ وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ عِنْدَهُ بِمِقْدَارٍ. Allah speaks about those orbits are go, those stars and those planets are going into very, very well designed orbits. And they don't intersect each other, basically, they don't go across each other so that they don't basically fall in accidents. Everything has been well organized. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala organizes everything. But that day when it comes, Allah gives the order and the command for this system to start collapsing. So what happened else? What else happened to them on that day? Allah Azza wa Jal says, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. Everyone upon the earth will perish, and they will remain, and they will remain the face of your Lord, honor of majesty and honor. Means Allah Azza wa Jal says that what's going to happen is that everything that you know will perish. Everything, everyone that you know will perish. How about the animals? Are they going to stay? They're not going to stay. What about the big animals, such as elephants and all these huge animals, for example, even sea animals? Everything will perish. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ. Everything and everyone upon the earth will perish. So, there will be no more life after that. And Allah Azza wa Jalla mentioned another ayah, and also the Prophet ﷺ described that in the hadith as well, is that on that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call لِمَنِ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ. To whom the kingdom and the dominions of the heavens and the earth belong. No one will be answering, right? No king will come to kind of answer this question, because no one's there to answer the question. And Allah calls subhanahu wa ta'ala لِمَنْ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمِ, and no one will answer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he answers by saying لِلَّهِ الْوَاحِدُ الْقَهَارِ. It is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one and only Al-Qahar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will answer this, showing his glory, showing his kingdom, and showing, of course, his might and his power over all this creation subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now also Allah Azza wa Jal says that إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ. Even though we say كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَا فَانْ, everything will perish, but still the ayah in Surah Az-Zumar says وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَصَائِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ, except whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. The question is, who are they? What are they? If Allah says in the ayah, إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ, so those who, there are some categories of people, categories of creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, will be saved from that blast. So the blast is going to kind of destroy everything. So who are these people who are going to be saved from this destruction? Now the ulama, they argue, but you know, the categories of people, the categories of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will be saved. So number one, they say the angels. The angels will be saved. However, why they say they will be saved? Because they're made out of arwah, souls. And the ayah speaks about, you know, the people of the earth. The people of the earth, in particular, and the samawat. Of course, now the ayah says, as samawat, the angels as well included. So the majority of the ulama of Al-Sunnati wal-Jama'ah, they say the angels are included in that shock, and they won't be exempted. Some other ulama, they say maybe few angels, like Jibreel, Israfil, the one who was responsible for blowing into that horn, and so on. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will exempt some of these angels. We have no confirmation. We do not have any confirmation from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specifically about these angels, who is going to be exempt from this blast. So Allah ta'ala alam. But it's all in the hand of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Whomever He wills for them to survive, they shall survive. Some of the ulama, they say the residents of Al-Jannah will be saved from that blast. Residents of Al-Jannah. Who are these residents of Al-Jannah? There is a Shuhada, there is an Anbiya perhaps, there is also some of the creation that Allah designated for Al-Jannah. And these are the ones that they say they will be saved from this blast. Why? Because this blow actually is not relevant to them at all. It's not relevant to them. So they might be exempted, because they are by themselves maybe the reward for the people of Al-Jannah when they return, when they are resurrected. There's some of the ulama, they say Al-Arwah, the souls, because death and destruction happens on the bodies, not the souls. And that's now just, again, another speculative opinion, but Wallahu A'lam, since the angels who are also made of Noor will be considered, you know, spirits as well, they will be destroyed. So the souls of humans who are still now in heavens with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can also be destroyed. Musa alayhi salam, there's a controversy over Musa alayhi salam. Will Musa alayhi salam be among those who will be exempted from that blast or not? The Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that the first person to be resurrected, something we're going to discuss next week inshallah, the first person to be resurrected on Judgment Day or on the day of resurrection will be the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he will say, when I come out, when I come to Allah azza wa jal, basically when I come to the day of Hashr, the space of Al-Hashr where they all congregate, said, I will see Musa alayhi salam holding to one of the pillars of the throne of Allah azza wa jal. I wouldn't know if Musa came before me, means if he was resurrected, if he woke up before me, or if Musa alayhi salam was exempt from being, you know, destroyed from that blast. Why? Because he had his share first time. When was that time when he was actually, when he was destroyed in that blast? When he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbi, arini andur ilayk, can I see you? So Allah said, you won't be able to see me, but if the mountains can stand, you will stand for that. And Musa also, he was shot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not allow these two shocks to happen to him twice. So that's why some of the ulama, they say, this could be the reason why Musa was exempt. And again, the answer to this is Allah ta'ala alam, but that's a speculative evidence from some of the ulama. What should we say to protect ourselves from that? We're going to come to question, inshallah. What should we say to protect ourselves from this event? This is now towards the first blast, as we said, the first time when they blow in the horn. That's what's going to happen. So how can we protect ourselves? And what should we say in order to ask Allah protection from this event? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as it was mentioned in Hadith Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu ta'ala, as was reported in Sunan Tirmidhi, is that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, how could I relax when the bearer of the horn has put the horn to his lips and tilted his forehead and is listening out, waiting for the command to blow the horn? So the Prophet himself at that time, 1500 years ago, he said, how can I relax when I know for sure that the angel Israfil is already holding that horn, and he puts it on his lips, waiting for the command to be given to him? The Muslims asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ya Rasulullah, what should we say then? How can we protect ourselves from that? He said, قُولُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ تَوَكَّلْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ رَبُّنَا. Again, he taught them to say, حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ تَوَكَّلْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ رَبُّنَا, which means Allah is sufficient for us, and He is the best disposer of affairs. We put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord. Repeat that dua, ya jama'ah. Let's repeat that together. حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ تَوَكَّلْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى اللَّهِ رَبُّنَا. So we put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every time keep reminding yourself of that dua. Every day in the morning and in the evening, remind yourself, حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ تَوَكَّلْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ رَبُّنَا. حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ تَوَكَّلْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ رَبُّنَا. Frequently keep repeating that dua over and over again, inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Now, the second time. So we spoke about the first event, and the second time is will be tied up, inshallah ta'ala, with the next week's topic, which is the resurrection. But just as an introduction to this topic, inshallah ta'ala, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. Then it will be blown again, and at once they will be standing looking on. So this is what we call in the Arabic language, al-ba'thu wal-nushur. The first time was for the destruction of everything. The first time was for the destruction of everything. The second time was for the resurrection of whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the permission to be resurrected. Because everything is going to come out. Allah will allow the humans and the animals. But not everything else will come out, actually, except for whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills. What matters to us here right now is two things. The humans, first and foremost, of course, and then the animals. Because the animals will share a specific event that people will see on the Day of Judgment. But what's important again for us is the event with the humans. قال تعالى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. People will be standing up and we'll be looking just kind of surprised that they're back to life, and now they're waiting for the command where to go. They know that something's happening, and now they're going to need to go into one direction. How are they going to look like? Where are they going to be heading? We'll discuss that in details next week, inshallah ta'ala. But for now, just to show you some of these events as Allah described in the Quran again, the second blast, He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in Surah Yasin, وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَإِذَا هُمْ مِنَ الْأَجْدَاثِ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَنْسِلُونَ. And the horn will be blown, and at once from the graves to their Lord, they will hasten and they will rush. So they will come out, and they start heading towards one direction, going towards the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they come out, that's after the second time, the second blast, when they come out, they would say, قَالُوا يَا وَيْلَنَا يَا وَيْلَنَا Woe to us! Man ba'athana min marqadina. Who raised up us from our sleeping? They thought they were sleeping. هذا Allah subhanahu answering saying, هذا ما وعد الرحمن وصدق المرسلون. This is what the Most Merciful had promised. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the messengers told the truth, that the day will come and it's already here. إن كانت, and Allah is saying, إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم جميع لدينا محضرون. It will not be but one blast. And once they are all brought present before us, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is confirming again that this is going to be only one blast, no more, that will bring the people back to life in a way that we'll describe later, inshallah. Some of it was mentioned here in this hadith of Nabi salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. How will people basically will be resurrected? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that on that day when the command comes again to the angel, when the command comes again to the angel to blow second time, the people starts coming. But how will they come out anyway? They come out, Allah has said that there will be rain coming down first. Rain will come down. And from that rain, they will start coming out. From that rain, they start growing. Humans will start growing. Can you even imagine that sight? Rain will come down and humans growing. If you look into it if you try to animate that in your mind, it's an amazing sight. And we can again explain that next week, inshallah. As a matter of fact, some of the ulama, they said, the way people come out from earth, they come out layers after layers. Because, you know, even the dirt that you guys are walking on, perhaps it is belongs to someone that survived or lived thousands of years ago. When they die, they are put into the graves, and then they become into dust, and that dust starts being blown here and there. SubhanAllah, just goes all over the place. Dust and ashes go all over the place. So Allah subhanahu will bring them back together, and people just start coming out layers after layers. They grow on, they're going layers after layers, just like when the herbs and the greens and the grass starts growing. This is exactly how people look like as they grow so fast, which means they grow basically from the stems and they grow so fast as they become full humans. This is an example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned multiple times in the Quran. Multiple times in the Quran. One of those examples, as I mentioned in Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُرْسِلُ الرِّيَاحَ بُشْرًا بَيْنَ يَدَى رَحْمَتِهِ. A wind that will be blown, and that wind will take with it, will bring a rahmah. Rahmah, that means that it brings basically the clouds, which is carrying the rain, which is a mercy for the people. حَتَّى إِذَا أَقَلَّتْ سَحَابًا ثِقَالًا. Until it have carried heavy rain clouds. سُقُنَاهُ لِبَلَدٍ مَيِّتْ. Allah says, we drive them to a dead land, a dead and barren land. فَأَنْزَلْنَا بِهِ الْمَاءِ. And we send down the rain. فَأَخْرَجْنَا بِهِ مِنْ كُلِّ الثَّمَرَاتِ. And bring forth thereby some of all fruits. Everything. That same rain brings all these fruits. Then he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, كَذَلِكَ نُخْرِجُ الْمَوْتَى لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Thus will we bring forth the dead, perhaps you may be reminded. After explaining how Allah brings life back to a dead land, how vegetation and greens grow by sending this rain, he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the way we'll bring the dead back to life. So the rain will come down and these people start growing. Where were they going to grow? Where they grow from, of course? The Messenger of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he mentioned that there will be this bone, so or the entire body will perish completely, except what is called in the Arabic language, adamatul dhahr, which is the last portion of the spine, the coccyx, that is basically it's going to remain and stay like a seed. So these are will remain in the earth like the seed. It's extremely small and tiny. It's extremely small and tiny. But this will be like the seed from which, you know, the human being will be brought back together. It carries, like, you know, it carries you, not just your genes. It's carrying everything, all the design. It's just like that chip. This is the chip, the divine chip that has all the information about you and how to reconstruct that body and how to bring it back again the way it used to be years and years and years before. So the Prophet ﷺ says between the two horn, or the blast, there will be 40. He didn't say 40 what? We don't know there are going to be 40 days, 40 years, 40 centuries, 40 ages. Only Allah knows. Time to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is irrelevant. Time to Allah azza wa jal, because it is everlasting. He's not really calculated. That's completely irrelevant to him. It's relevant to us. So how much time is that? Allahu ta'ala alam. But then Allah Azza will give the command for water to come down, and that water will reach these small pieces of bones that will be like the seeds again. As it reaches, the water just going to bring everything back to life. It just like the water reaches these bones, and the bones, once they get to the water, they get the energy and start reconstructing the body by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once they are brought now completely full humans, and they look around, they see themselves up again, wondering what happened, who brought us back again to life, how are we back here right now? Then the command will come to them to congregate towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, another event that is called Al-Hashr, which will be our discussion inshallah ta'ala next week with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Al-Hashr, just to give you an idea, Al-Hashr now is the first event that will be up in the heavens. So the people will be gathered on earth, and then there's some sort of mechanism and some sort of like an event that will take them all up in groups and congregations. We explain that next week inshallah, and they will meet their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, and from there we go to different events of that day until people, they go into Al-Jannah and go into Jahannam. May Allah protect us all from Jahannam and make us all a jama'ah from people of Jannah. Wallahu ta'ala alam. Any question? Yes.
The jinns are also the creation of Allah. So will they be also excited?
Question. Will the jinn be resurrected as well? What do you guys think? Absolutely. Absolutely. Al-jinn wal-ins will be resurrected, and they will be coming to be questioned, and they will be held accountable for their actions. Wallahu alam. Yes. Talking about the punishment of the Day of Judgment. So when the body are reconstructed and the humans were resurrected, does it mean that the punishment on the Day of Judgment will be on the body? The answer to this question will be in details later, inshallah, as we talk about this, when we come to the subject of Na'im, which means the pleasure of the paradise. Is it physical? Is it carnal delight? Is it something to enjoy? Just something moral? Or even just intellectual? Same thing with the punishment. We're going to discuss that in details later on, bin Allah Azza wa Jalla. But for now, the answer is yes. It's going to be for both the soul and the body. Yes? Yes. Allahu Alam. We don't know the details, except just like we mentioned earlier, there will be actually, like we said, those will be exempt. Some of the ulama, they say the angels. Some they say no, few angels, such as Jibril, Israfil, Mikael, and other mentioned by name. Residents of Al-Jannah, whoever is in Al-Jannah already, by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will not be subject to this blast. Some they say the souls, because the destruction only happens on the bodies, so the souls will not be destroyed. And some they say Musa alayhi salam among humans will be exempt from that blast. All these are speculative, opinions from the ulama. Nothing confirmed in terms of, who's going to be exempt. Allah says just, illa man sha Allah. Except whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills, we don't know whom Allah Azza will exempt him from that blast. Nah. The Prophet ﷺ, when he was mentioning these examples of the people being completely heedless of the Day of Judgment and the start of the Day of Judgment, these are real examples. He said that people will be doing that. Now here's the thing. These are now examples that people of the desert will be able to relate to. That doesn't mean this is what all people on earth will be doing. There will be people in Europe doing something else, people in Africa doing something else, in Asia, in the Americas. Whatever activities, that life activity they do usually, they're going to be doing these activities. So the meaning of these examples, just to show you how heedless the people are about that day, and how completely they're unaware of the imminence of that day. Wallahu a'lam. Yes? And then the last one, the angel of death, will also be destroyed.
So if that hadith
So the angel of death might be the one, might be among those who will be exempt from that blast. But then once he finishes his duty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he just ordered his death as well. So he might not be subject to that blast, but deferred, you know, kind of any consequences for him. Allah ta'ala. Nah. Yes, I didn't want to bring that into controversy. Some of them, they said there are going to be three. But it's a controversy that I don't want to mention it in details here. But I'll bring it just the most common opinion to have two. Wallahu a'lam. Sisters, any question? Yes? The dua itself? Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakil. Tawakkalna ala Allahi Rabbuna. Any question? Sisters? Khair inshallah. Next week when we come back, bin Allah Azza, we'll be talking, bin Allah Ta'ala, we'll be discussing Al-Hashr, means the congregation, and how exactly people are going to come out from their graves, how they're going to look like, their ages, their bodies, direction, where they're going to be congregated on earth, and how the arrival to the main station of Hashr will look like in heavens. We'll discuss that next week, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.